For this man, work is sometimes play. He's the president of a new contender in the home video game wars. The game he's playing is called Atlantis, and it's about to be introduced to the public. If all goes according to his plan, he stands to make millions. But this is a game full of surprises. This week on Enterprise, All in the Game.
I'm Eric Severide. If you weren't watching me right now, you might well be playing this, a home video game. That'd be a mistake, of course, but understandable. This year, Americans will spend $1.5 billion on game cartridges alone. Add the revenue from arcade machines and home consoles, and you have a $7 billion a year industry, one that barely existed 5 years ago. Until recently, the business was dominated by a single giant. But the explosion in the game's popularity and profits has drawn a dozen new competitors into the marketplace. This young and aggressive industry has now become a volatile one as well, where the stakes and the risks are high. This week on Enterprise, we follow a new company that hopes to stake its claim in what may be the biggest gold rush in the history of the entertainment business.
For Bill Grubb, a new Mercedes is not just a luxury, but part of the trappings of success in California's Silicon Valley. The son of a New York City cop, Grubb first came west in 1979 to work for Atari as vice president of marketing and sales. By 1981, he was convinced video games were a bonanza and that he should stop making money for Atari and try making it for himself. The result was a new game company called Imagic, with the 38-year-old Bill Grubb as president. He founded the company with three partners who had an average age of 28.
I finished my game.
I don't believe it. Brian.
Honest to God.
Brian Dougherty, 26, was a video game designer and engineer for Mattel's Intellivision.
Decided to drop out the dragon.
No, so we're going to have to change the name of the game, yeah.
Jim Goldberger, 28, was a marketing analyst for Mattel.
In the latest issue of video games,
Dennis Koble, 32, came with Grubb from Atari, where he was a game designer and supervisor. What made the partners so eager to go out on their own? The industry's dazzling sales figures, expected to top $3 billion this year, more than half of it in software, the game cartridges themselves. The backbone of the business is a growing army of button-pushing kids who vicariously pilot spaceships, battle dragons, slalom down mountainsides, sack quarterbacks, demolish race cars, catch fish, or even bid no trump at bridge. This subculture of video game fanatics is huge, as are potential profits, and Bill Grubb wants a piece of the action.
I want Imagic to be the best damn software company that's available in this marketplace. I want our people to have the opportunity to grow, to be challenged, and I think we all want to be able to participate in the riches that those things will afford us.
But to get those riches, Imagic first needed games. So Grubb raided Atari and Mattel for more game designers and set them loose.
This mothership, it's like orbiting around the Earth, but it doesn't have the fuel to land. And all these small ships are traveling down to try and attack.
Not another space shoot 'em
up. Brian, they sell.
I'd like it to be a space shoot 'em up. You just pick up the controls and start firing. But I'd like it to progress and have more and more options as the play progresses.
Well, as we all know, space shoot-em-ups really have been the hottest for the last year and a half. Let's take a look.
Most of our designers are in their 20s. Our marketing people are in their late 20s, early 30s. People have to, I guess, have a feel for that younger generation, for what turns them on, what gives them fun.
Oh, we're making this an Intellivoice cartridge, I guess.
I gotta tell you, on this trip and stuff, you know, we played B-17, and it's a kick. I mean, it really is. Mattel Electronics presents B-17 Bomber. You know, it's really kind of...
It's no secret that I was working on voice when I was at Mattel, and...
You're well-known guy.
Why did you do that, Brian? All right. But no, I mean, I think that's the most important thing, is that if we do a voice game, making sure that the voice is part of the gameplay and it's not just another
just
sound effect.
Regular.
You know, all I can tell you is what a 10-year-old boy thought of it, and he thought it was absolutely terrific. I mean,
in January 1982, Dennis Koble hit on an idea for a space shoot-em-up game based on the lost city of Atlantis. In his version, Atlantis will be attacked by alien spaceships, which the player must shoot down.
It was such a natural, because everybody knows what Atlantis is. Everybody's heard that. That's good mythology.
The bulk of Koble's early decisions about Atlantis are worked out on a computer. The game will have a limited amount of memory, and Koble must juggle graphics, sound effects, and the gameplay itself.
Technologically, you can't always do what you want. You find that you don't have quite enough memory, or perhaps the graphics just don't seem to come out quite right, or the colors or the sounds, and you find that many times you have to make sacrifices in one area to get some other effect or something else in. At times it's very fun. At times it can be extraordinarily frustrating. And there's a lot of pressure, an extreme amount of pressure, because in any business that generates as much money as this does, there's the pressure on you to continue to produce one hit after another, and that's not possible.
After the preliminary computer work, Koble begins to design the look of the game itself. By February, he has a primitive version ready.
These various blocks up here are going to represent the various alien ships that are going to come down and basically destroy Atlantis at the end of the game. Right now, I don't have the graphics for the ships yet, so I've just basically put in some blocks to indicate where the ships are going to be. And right now, they just kind of bounce from one side of the screen to the other. In the final game, of course, they will have much more realistic motion.
Okay, so these are the new Atlantis ships I've been working up.
Koble's spaceships are designed with the aid of a graphic artist and a computer animator.
Looks like I'm going to have about enough room for maybe three or four actual ship pictures in the game, the way things are looking right now. That's kind of nice. That's really nice. If that was moving very fast, that'd be really nice for, like, you know, very hard to hit, very fast moving little ship. I like it.
Yeah.
It looks good. Atlantis is basically a space shoot-em-up, typically the most mass-marketed type, or oriented type games. In other words, you're going to sell two games of given quality level. If one of them is a space shoot-em-up, another one is a strategy game, you're going to sell more space shoot-em-ups.
And selling more games is important to Koble. Designers get royalties on their games, up to 2% of gross sales. If Atlantis is a big success, Koble will make a great deal of money.
You know, I stand to make an awful lot of money off of it, you know. You know, several hundred thousand dollars.
But Atlantis's competition will be fierce. When Imagic was formed, there were only three competitors to worry about. Atari was the first video game company and is still far and away the industry leader, producing both hardware, the systems the games are played on, and software, the actual games. Mattel, with its Intellivision games, is next, also producing both hard and software. But a revolution of sorts was started by Activision, a company which produces only the more profitable game software, which can be played on Atari or Mattel hardware. Imagic is trying to follow Activision's lead.
Activision is a $66 million company. They have a good deal of money in the bank. They have some sharp marketing and salespeople, so they are really our main competition.
Activision's success spawned not only Imagic, but a host of other companies.
You can see Spectrevision, U.S. Games, Apollo, Tiger Vision, Coleco, Parker Brothers, 20th Century Fox, Arcadia, Atari, Mattel, Activision. In fact, we even have a competitor that's right next door to us now, Data Age, as well as ourselves. We'll all be writing software for either the Atari or the Mattel system.
As some of you were able to see, there's a new company called Arcadia, and they're using a whole different medium to store the game itself, and that in itself is frightening to me. I don't know whether it's a death wish or what it is, but that now opens up the whole arena for piracy to start happening.
They're making it to work with any standard cassette. If they were to achieve any sort of significant penetration with the unit, they'd only sell one tape for, you know, every several customers, because kids are going to, you know, take and make a copy over their friend's house. All it takes is an ordinary, you don't even need an expensive quality tape.
I have some real concerns as to what this company is doing.
Dennis Koble's major concern is still Atlantis, which by March is beginning to take shape.
Okay, at this point in time, things are coming together really well. The cities have basically been positioned, as are the bridges and the various factories, and they're all positioned correctly, and I have the graphics in at this point. The ships are being launched, although the graphics are still being trashed out at times, which indicates I've got a problem I've got to fix. And the motion is starting to become like I envision it, but I obviously going to have to do some work on that still. Their shots are active, although they're not moving fast enough. I can see that right now. And they also don't come out right on the barrels of the guns, which means I've got to work on that a little bit. And then I think at that point we'll start to have a pretty good game.
Imagic's first three games are released in the spring. Within weeks, one of them, Demon Attack, proves so successful that Bill Grubb raises his sales goal for 1982.
Our plan for calendar 1982 was to do between $10 and $11 million. With the early shipment of product in March and April, we now feel very confident that we will be able to do at least $25 million in this calendar year.
Grubb's optimism is also fueled by 10 new games scheduled for summer release, including Imagic's first games for the Intellivision system. These 10 games will form the heart of the company's Christmas sales push. Leading the pack will be Dennis Koble's Atlantis. In May, Koble has a prototype ready.
Basically, you have bad guys or alien ships that start off in a high orbit, and basically they work their way down a level at a time, and when they reach the bottom level, they'll turn on a death ray and try to destroy one of your installations in Atlantis. And you have three bases by which you can defend Atlantis. There's a center base, which is your most valuable because it's easiest to time your shots to hit the bad guys, or the side bases, which you basically have to shoot an angled shot. It's much more difficult. I give you a lot more points for doing that because it is more difficult. And we can actually go
ahead. By now, the game is ready to be played.
On the first wave, it's a wave-oriented game. The ships, they start working their way down. They're pretty slow, and basically I'm using the center base because it's very easy to hit them. And I'll use a side base here to get some of the shots. And as we progress through the waves, the ships will start to speed up. And as the ships, as they work their way down, you tend to lose portions of Atlantis. And what happens is I've got five installations here left. I'll let them go ahead and take me out here. As you can see, it gets pretty frenetic in the later waves here.
After development, Imagic's games are usually tested by kids while they're watched through a one-way mirror.
Okay, big smile over there on that one. You like that? Neither one has looked to the other one yet. I mean, to blame the other one for missing.
Yeah, that's right.
Game's over, guys.
Okay, so what did you think of that game?
Wow.
Hey, that says it all.
Blowing up.
Me, baby.
What about you, John? What do you like about it?
I like the way it's detailed. Everything looks detailed and realistic.
We have them hooked.
If the game seems like a winner, the next step is production. The production process is a simple one. The brain of each Atlantis game is a microchip and circuit board, costing about $3. The chips have been manufactured with the Atlantis program built into their memory. They are then merely placed in plastic cartridges, and a game is born. The entire process costs under $5 a game. Atlantis will then be sold to wholesalers for $16. By the time it hits retail shelves, it will sell for $26 to $32. That's assuming, of course, that the game does sell.